We are all familiar with today's episode of Jesus curing the 10 lepers, and where only one showed him gratitude in return. Let us first note that leprosy is a disease that caused immense suffering and pain. Leprosy terrified humanity since ancient times, as early as 600 BC. It is a disease of the nervous system that caused tissues to degenerate and the disfiguring of skin and bones. The loss of pain sensations caused further nerve damage. And with advanced leprosy, a leper's finger and feet may be eaten by rats in their sleep, and they would be unaware of it. During the time of Jesus, lepers were banished from their families and communities, as the disease was not only contagious, but also associated with one's sinfulness. Even a leper's shadow is considered unclean and can contaminate people they come into contact with. As such, wherever a leper goes, he has to cover his disfigured face and body, which is considered repulsive, and ring a bell and call out, "Unclean, unclean." They are not allowed to come within 30 feet of any person. It is within this context of such great suffering that the 10 lepers in today's gospel pleads, "Jesus, Master, take pity on us." Moved with great mercy, Jesus cures them and instructs them to present themselves to the priest to certify that they have been healed and can be reinstated with their community once again. My brothers and sisters in Christ, let us imagine ourselves being one of the lepers and being cured. Would we not be overjoyed and filled with deep gratitude for Jesus curing us? Sadly, we know that from today's gospel, only one returned to show gratitude to Jesus, while the rest were so overtaken by their healing, they easily forgotten the merciful love of Jesus. My sisters and brothers in Christ, you and I, hearing the gospel event, are surely very puzzled and may be asking ourselves, how is it that the 9 lepers are so ungrateful to Jesus? Let us reflect on this further so that we do not become too judgmental and hasty towards the ungrateful lepers. A relevant question that we need to ask ourselves is, have we also, in many ways in our life's experiences, like the 9 lepers, feel overjoyed with the good fortunes and good happenings in our lives, but are also guilty of forgetting to thank God and be grateful to Him for the abundant blessings that we have received? We may understand the leprosy episode in today's gospel more clearly if we perhaps take the disease as a symbol of the many forms of painful sufferings in our lives and in the world today. In this symbolic sense, the leprosy of the gospel reminds us of the suffering that disfigures the goodness and love and truth that God has planted in our hearts when He created us. The leprosy of today's world would also be the suffering that disfigures and destroys the unity and love, respect and care that we once had in our families. They are also the suffering of the loss of the sense of dignity of the human person in our world. These sufferings also include the numbness of the heart that so easily exploit, abuse, and dehumanize all peoples through the evils and injustice of the world, and justifies the destructions of human lives through wars, ethnic cleansing, scientific testing, euthanasia, abortion, and the like, not forgetting the murders perpetrated by extremists in ideologies and religions. This list can continue, but let us also draw the suffering of the lepers of today's gospel to on a personal level of suffering. For let us also reflect on the test for this, let us reflect on the testimony of the immense suffering and trauma of Lisa Duffy's divorce. In other words, as we reflect on Lisa's personal sufferings, as symbolized in the suffering of the lepers, let us ask ourselves, in our personal suffering, can we live in the hope that God will come to our rescue and that He will never abandon us because of His merciful love for us? And if this is so, then would we more likely respond like the Samaritan leper who showed gratitude to Jesus, or would we be more likely represent the ungrateful 9 lepers? Lisa Duffy shares, divorce changes life on almost every level possible, physically, financially, emotionally, and intellectually. It is one of the most difficult aspects to deal with, because for at least half of the spouses, they didn't want or ask for this change, and they feel it as the worst thing that could happen to them in their lives. Lisa shares further, if you are in a great deal of pain or finding it difficult to deal with the loneliness and depression that often accompanies it, it is normal for the deep hurt and betrayal that is traumatizing you. In my own experience, my life was suddenly in black and white after my spouse walked out. Food had no pleasing flavor, jokes were not funny, and the world just seemed cold and gray. How could I find something to be grateful for when nothing was the way it was supposed to be? How could I even think of being thankful when I was in such a great pain? Gratitude seems to be as impossible to achieve to me as it was to consider forgiving those who had hurt me. But God always has a merciful and gentle way of leading us back to Him. As for me, it would be through a documentary on World War II and the Holocaust that I watched one night on TV. I was captivated by the story of a young woman, Jessie, not her real name, who was a prisoner of the Bergen-Belsen concentration camp. One morning, Jessie had been raped and starving and found herself in line one morning for the showers where she will be gassed to death. However, miraculously, Jessie and another young woman found a loose panel in the shower wall just moments before the gas was turned on, and they quietly escaped. They ran in the freezing snow for miles until they found an American troops who rescued them. And here Jessie was later, an old woman with rosy cheeks who had gone on to live a full life and found happiness. In spite of the fact that she had lost her entire family and had suffered so greatly, she was never bitter. In all this, and was possible because Jessie was able to thank God for all the blessings in spite of the suffering she had to embrace. Lisa shared further, I was so affected by this Jessie story that I had to ask myself, is there anything stopping me from doing the same thing? My answer was, there was nothing. So with God's grace, from that day onwards, my perspective of life and suffering changed. More importantly, I was able to go beyond my pain and suffering and see the abundant graces that God continued to give to me. As I reflect on my life, I began to realize that since my divorce from Mark, not his real name, I was suddenly free to practice my Catholic faith. Even though I had married a Catholic, Mark, my ex-husband, never practiced the faith. So I usually went to Mass alone and was given a hard time practicing my Catholic faith, as Mark would ridicule me when I do so. Now I could practice my faith freely. Realizing this brought me much consolation. I also realized that the terrible fighting and arguments that went on had now stopped. There are also no more yelling and no more angry insults in the home, and my home was peaceful once again. My attitude of gratefulness began to grow, and after a while, I was able to recognize the many ways I had been blessed by God since my divorce, painful as it may be. In further reflecting on her divorce, Lisa advises, remember that your divorce does not define you. God made you a beautiful creature. You have strengths and you have talents, a uniqueness that when offered with generosity brings meaning, consolation, and happiness to others. No one is without such gifts from God, and you should sit down and make your list of your strengths and your blessings that God has given you that are so precious to you. Why are such positive and Christ-like views important, you may ask? Lisa says, there's a need to affirm the good things about ourselves. When a marriage ends, often one and both spouses walk away with a loss of self-confidence or with a sense of inadequacy. Recognizing and affirming your gifts, talents, and blessings from God has and continues to be essential because life has to go on in God's love and ways and mercy. Gratitude enables you to move forward and to say, I have survived that pain and I'm better for it. Gratitude heals your heart and provides a multitude of reasons to wake up in the morning and get out of bed. And a thankful heart paves the way to healing and recognizing God's plan and mercy for you in your life. And so, my brothers and sisters in Christ, as I conclude, let us remind ourselves that the 10 lepers in today's gospel is a symbol for our reflection on the intense pain and widespread suffering in our lives and in the world. The suffering that is caused by so much injustice and the evils of the world that destroys life both globally and on the personal level. As in the gospel, let us more importantly reaffirm that Jesus is always present to us and the suffering people, regardless of who we are and what pain we may be suffering. As Jesus was with the 10 lepers, he will also show us his merciful love to give us the strength to sustain us and rescue us from such seemingly impossible trials and tribulations of our lives, as he did in the true story of Lisa, and who experienced a conversion of heart when she watched the documentary of Jesse in our story, who herself experienced the healing grace of God and was able to affirm the merciful love of God that brought her new hope and new meaning in life without bitterness of her persecutors. Let us remind too that as God is merciful to us, and as God has blessed us in great abundance and have rescued us from all the different trials and trauma of life, we are called to be like the Samaritan leper, to be grateful to God at all times. You and I are not perfect. We are all sinners. We are all human beings subject to different pains and trials of life. We must recognize that as God is always merciful to us, we must also be grateful to God for all the blessings and strength that he has given us at all times. God never fails. We must not fail him with a gratitude heart. It is only when our hearts are grateful to God that we can then live a life of peace and forgiveness and the meaning of faith that brings hope to others too who are suffering in this world. Let us pray for this wisdom, and let us pray that God will give us the graces like the grateful Samaritan leper to see how merciful God is for us and how we too are called to be forgiving and merciful to others who have hurt us and caused us harm. It is through the witness of the gospel that we can build a church and bring hope to the world. I'd like us to ponder on these challenges of the gospel for a few moments and allow the truth and the mercy of God to open our minds and fill our hearts with renewed hope, healing, and strength.